So welcome everybody to the plenary session today. My name is Thomas Jaitner from TU Dortmund University, and I have the honor to share this session together with Thomas Abel. Thomas is also with the German Sports University in Cologne, such as our first speaker, and there he holds the endowed chair for Paralympic sports, which is, to our knowledge, unique in the world. The third I for in this plenary stands for inclusion. Inclusion in sports has become a key topic not only in social sciences, but also in the natural sciences. I will highlight this point, and you should just remember Oscar Pistorius, or lately Markus Rehm, an amputee long jumper who won the German championship in 2014 with 8.24 meters. And then claimed to compete at the 2016 Olympic Games in Rio. This raised a tremendous debate, not only in the National Track and Field Association, but also in the International Federation. And finally, he did not compete, but the discussion is still going on. So in our plenary session, we will hear two talks that address the topic inclusion from both the humanities and a biomechanics perspective. And it's my great pleasure now and a great honor to introduce Professor Peter Brüggemann from Cologne, the German Sports University. He is professor for biomechanics and director of the Institute of Biomechanics and Orthopedics. And his research includes topics like clinical orthopedic biomechanics, biomechanics at the workplace, and biomechanics in sports. His research is focused on macroscopic and microscopic answers of biological tissue on mechanical loads and on quantification of mechanical loads on biological tissue in sports and at work. A major point of emphasis is on bone, cartilage, and the muscle-tendon connection. Besides these fields, Peter Brüggemann is interested in the influence of technical and sports equipment on mechanical loads in sports and everyday life. For this reason, he carried out intensive research on sport shoes, as well as on the effect of orthoses and prosthetics. One of his most cited papers in this field was on the biomechanics of double transtibial amputee sprinting. His excellent research brought out more than 150 papers in highly ranked journals. Peter Brüggemann was a member of the IOC Medical Commission, as well as of the Council of the International Society of Biomechanics. And he received numerous honors and awards. In 2008, he was awarded as a honorary professor of the Shanghai University. So I think we are now looking for a very inspiring talk. Please, Peter, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for this nice introduction. So I want to share some thoughts with you concerning technology and the effect of technology to load management, as well as to sports performance. And technology from this perspective are prostheses, orthoses, exoskeletons, and some other stuff. And then I try to move the path and go the journey into the idea or in the discussion of inclusion. Technology should have the potential to enhance performance. Technology likes exoskeletons. Technology should have an impact on load and may be used for injury prevention, for example, through an orthosis. I want to start with this specific question. Is it effective? Is technology effective for performance enhancement? Is it effective for injury prevention? And I want to start with an idea presented by Collins in 2015 in Nature. They designed an exoskeleton to increase the plantar flexion moment during walking or also during running. A very simple device, mechanical, a passive device. And what is remarkably, this device is able to increase the plantar flexion moment, which means independent of the stiffness of the springy thing, of the spring, the moment to plantar flex during the push-off in gait or in running increase. And remarkably, the effect is dramatic. So we have here the net metabolic rate, which means the oxygen consumption, and what we can nicely see, we have a drop of oxygen consumption using this device by about 7%. So using this technology, we have a down regulation of the metabolic uptake, and that means we have an increase of performance. Very simple, but it works. Technology provides potential to decrease energy demand, and from that we can derive enhanced performance. What about injury prevention? For example, an orthosis like that, producing a valgus moment to the knee, reduces the external adduction moment, which is related to an increased medial compartment knee loading. So, which means with a brace, we have a lower EAM, a lower external adduction moment, which means technology provides the potential to decrease the external adduction moment and decrease the medical loading, the medial loading. So we have an intraarticular load management which moved the load from medial more to lateral. Technology works. And I like to show that with an internal pass of pressure or the center of pressure. And we nicely see with no brace we have a very unstable knee, while with such a brace we have a more stable knee. Technology has a potential to stabilize the knee. So both should be visible, injury prevention as well as performance. Technology has a potential to enable performance. And this was a very interesting paper from Brendan Burkett in 2010, which was entitled Technology in Paralympic Sport, Performance Enhancement or Essential for Performance. And it makes completely sense that, for example, if we have a handicapped rugby player playing rugby, he needs a wheelchair. So, which means this play, this kind of sport is completely different from normal able-bodied rugby playing. Or, for example, a sprinter with an amputation on one leg must need technology in order to be unable to start. Or a swimmer with an amputation of one arm has to have technology, and technology is essential just to perform. There is a need for technology to enable performance. Last year we saw, and we all noticed this interesting event, the Sabathlon in Zurich. Six disciplines, 66 teams from 25 countries, around more than 4,000 spectators. Assistance technology enabled performance, complete different performance than we know that from our traditional sport. New disciplines were created. Probably it was more a competition of technology, but it opened the way how we think about activity, sport, and exercise. Let's go a step forward. Surgical technology. And surgical technology sometimes enable performance. For example, we have here the loading of the hip joint during running, the forces and the moments. But if the femoral head has a huge damage, it's not possible for such a patient or such a person to perform. But with technology, this person is enabled to perform and to run and to produce ground reaction forces like he or she did it before, producing angle at the hip in all the three dimensions, so flexion, extension, adduction, abduction, internal rotation, like more or less a healthy person. And also the moments produced in these joints are completely normal, which means technology, surgical technology, enable to perform. And from that, we can think about human enhancement in general. So probably we can be preactive if, for example, in an athlete we see such a dysplasia. So we can think about a triple osteotomy in order to increase the coverage of the femoral head by a surgical intervention prior injury and prior a high level of performance. It's just a thought. Or looking into baseball pitches. As you may know, the LCU is a lateral collateral ligament of the elbow is highly loaded in baseball pitching. We have, during throwing, a valgus stress of around 65 newton meters. The problem is that these ligaments just take 30 newton meters, which means just 50% of the internal varus stress, which means there should be a solution with an artificial graft, which can make more than 35 newtons. So that means there was, a couple of years ago, this surgical prevention, the so-called Tommy Jones surgery. It's a figure eight graft on the medial elbow, so here, in order to increase the power or the withstand of this special joint. From 1994 to 2010, more than 1,600 of these surgeries are registered. Interestingly, and with an increasing number, around 25% are youth before they are on top performance. So, human enhancement, prevention. Is that acceptable? Do you or do we want that? Human enhancement, or the optimal use of athlete's biological potential, or the optimal tissue properties for a given task. Remarkably, we see some differences in different populations. For example, the tendon mechanical properties. Here we have the gastrocnemius medialis tendon for Kenyan runners and Caucasian controls. And we nicely see that the Kenyan have more than 30% longer tendons, so more elastic tissue or more material to store energy. Is that an advantage? And can we arrange things like that? Just an idea. Probably you remember the Pistorius case in 2008 when he applied to be accepted for the Olympics as a dumbbell transtibial amputee. Benonic, one of the most well-known biomechanists in that time, he wrote in BioMechL, after there was a positive decision that Pistorius can participate in the Olympics, I would like to challenge the biomechanics community to develop prostheses that will produce world records in many track and field disciplines. It should not be too difficult. And from this thought, I can add right now, we would like to challenge the orthopedic community to develop surgical techniques which will reinforce ligament and tendons, make them stiffer or more compliant, and increase their potential to store elastic energy in a given task. Or to modify, for example here, the lever arm of muscle tendons unit to increase the moments to the joints. It should not be too difficult. Probably the future. Technology has the potential to enable and to enhance performance. Yuge Herr from the MIT Boston, he's also a double transtibial amputee, he said People have always thought the human body is ideal. It's not. And he also said, when technology works, it can make you stronger or faster than you were overnight. So technology has an impact and has a huge impact. And let's think about running and running prosthesis. We all know that we have, for the different disabilities, different technical solutions. And we heard that the technical development was increased over the years. For example, the world record on the over the 100 meter sprint for the TT44 decreased independent on the increasing technology. For example, the first step was here when we changed from these wooden foot to a more elastic carbon plate or carbon prosthesis. The difference was here we had an energy return from this foot for about 30%, here of 84%. And then the lever arm for these prostheses increased in 2007. There was a prosthesis on the market which returned energy of more than 90%, and we had another drop in the record. So the message is performance is strongly related to technology. Let's think about running. We have here the joint power of the ankle joint, the knee joint, and the hip joint in slow running. So just 3.5 meters, so it's more kind of jogging. And we nicely see we have in the first phase of the stance, we have an absorption of energy in the ankle joint, and then we have the generation of energy. And when we are slow running, we have a higher generation than absorption of energy. In the knee is a little different, we have more absorption than generation. But when we are going faster, and we have here the ankle joint for the first step in the start, second, third, and fourth, we increase the absorption. And the absorption comes higher than the generation of energy, which is true in faster running. So we have higher absorption of energy in the ankle joint than generation. And this is related to the very short time for the muscles to work on this joint. And from the data from Roy and co-workers, we learned that, for example, for the ankle joint, we have much higher energy decrease when we are coming down, and we have just less energy generation when we take off for the push-off. And so we have a deficit or an energy loss of around 30%. And this is also true and for the knee, and just the hip is going to increase energy, which means we have a loss of energy when faster running in the ankle joint. And when we now try to explain what happens when running with a under knee prosthesis, we nicely see that for a sound ankle joint, we have a drop of the work, we have negative work, and the positive work in the second phase of the stance, it's much lower than the negative work, and it's opposite in the blade or in the carbon prosthesis, and we nicely see we have a huge amount of energy absorption and a huge amount of energy degeneration, a generation. That means we have just a little energy loss, much less energy loss than in the natural, in the healthy human ankle joint, which means we have less energy loss when running with such prosthesis in the ankle joint, which probably is an advantage. In addition, such a prosthesis has a reduced mass and a reduced moment of inertia. Just the moment of inertia has half of the value of an integer shank, foot, and shoe. which may help the amputee runner to be faster with a leg swinging to the next contact. And this was nicely shown by Peter Valiant and co-workers when they had the shorter time in the air for the amputee runners in respect or in regard to the intact limb sprinters. And in addition, a little longer contact time in order to exchange the elastic energy during in the prosthesis. When Oscar Pistorius visited our lab in late 2007, we also measured some physiological data with him, and so we took him on the ergometer in order to measure his VO2 uptake. And we compared this with healthy controls running at that time around the same speed. This was Oscar's speed for the 400 meters, or Oscar's time for 400 meters in our test run, and these are for the controls, or more or less same. And interestingly, Oscar Pistorius' VO2 update was around 30% lower than for the control sprinters. Then we asked them to run a 400 meter test run. Oscar in 51, the others in 52 seconds, so very close. Interestingly, over the run, we saw here in black the intact limb sprinters, in red, Oscar Pistorius, around 30% less VO2 during the run. And this is the entire run, which means he needs less energy. And the cause is he has less energy loss due to his prosthesis. And interestingly, Yu Chao, who was also in the CAS in this case, after the decision, he nicely said, Oscar Pistorius spent 34% less time in the air between steps, takes 21 less time to swing his legs between steps, and has a metabolic cost of running that is 17% lower than able-bodied sprinters. It was after the CAS decision. He also said prosthetic feet act like leaf springs on a truck. The bigger they are, the longer the lever arms, the more energy storage and return you get. And probably you remember the 200 meter final in London. After this final, Oscar Pistorius said to his opponent, "Hey, I never saw you so tall." So what he used, a longer lever or a longer leaf spring, which allowed him to store and to reutilize more energy. And have just a quick view to that. Oscar Pistorius on head. And now this guy with a longer prosthesis. He was a little taller for this race. Technology is strongly related to performance. Oscar did 46 steps per 100 meter in this race. Oliveira and Pistorius, 43. So an advantage related to technology. Let's move to the latest case. And you already mentioned this case. Long jump. And we had the chance to compare athletes with underknee prosthesis and non-amputee athletes jumping more or less similar distances. Interestingly, we have here the vertical ground reaction forces and the horizontal braking forces. And we see for the amputee jumpers or the blade jumpers, we only have very little braking force, while for the healthy jumpers, we have huge, up to 4 times body weight breaking force. And we have a complete different vertical paths or paths of vertical ground reaction forces, very smooth, like using a spring. Here we have this impact and then the push off from the ground. So it seems it's completely different. And when we have then a more closer look to what they are doing, we see the entire arrangement of the ground reaction forces is different in both. So different kinds of jumping. Or is it jumping or bouncing? When we look for the work on the center of mass, we have here a positive work which is around 56% of the negative work. While with the prosthesis, we see we have 114% of positive work in relation to the negative work, which means the sprinter is able to generate or to gain energy. And what, interestingly, we saw below the knee, the energy production below the knee is much higher using these prosthesis than using the healthy ankle joint. And with that, we can explain that these distances are possible to jump with prosthesis. And it's very similar to using this tool, this toy, these polarizers. And probably you know that these polarizers are ideal to store and to recover these elastic energy with a very low hysteresis. And probably some of you saw that it was, I think, some years later, when a person was jumping with springs under the feet over a running car. I think impressive. Technology is strongly related to performance. Just summarizing these thoughts. Technology has a potential to increase performance, for example, through less energy loss. Technology has a great capacity to enable athletes with impairment to practice and perform. Without technology, they cannot perform. Technology is essential and needed for their exercise. But technology may affect the fair competition and the fair comparison. Technology can increase the more efficient use of the human resources, especially the muscle or the tissue resources. Technology can protect for overuse and injury. Technology can be fitted to the individual or to a given group of users. But technology may, from this perspective, counteract inclusion and may enhance segregation. But we need reliable and sustainable rules of technology. And this is a sine qua non condition. Technology must be available for all participants to ensure equity, and the same technology for all. The use of technology calls new sports and new sport disciplines. From this perspective, inclusion of new sports will counteract segregation and will enhance attraction of sports, and especially sports for all. But I want to add, probably this is a new challenge, and the next challenge we have to think about, elective performance enhancement surgery. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Peter Brüggemann, for this really, really inspiring